time to take our places, open our hearts, and train our minds toward God's Holy Spirit and what He has to say to us today. If you're a guest, we want to say, welcome. We're glad you're here. And in order for us to recognize that you've been here with us today, we ask that you fill out the colored paper, brightly colored paper that's in the folder in the hymnal rack in front of you, and to just place it in the offering container during that time in our service. Also, if you have prayer requests, you can use the other part of that same paper, and the usher will pick those up during our focused prayer time. This can be for a prayer request or suggestion for visitation, things like that. Do we have any anniversaries this week? Pardon? No anniversaries this week? Let's see if I have any listed. I don't have any listed. And then how about birthdays? No birthdays this week? I have Florence Welch on my list.
Yes, she's turning 80.
Ooh, that's a big number. Florence is turning 80. So happy birthday to Florence. All right. Now let's look at the announcements that are in our bulletin. And then I have a couple of extra ones. The ones in the bulletin are that we want to thank the Allen Fink family who's placed flowers this morning in his loving memory. And then also remind you that today we're taking this, the offering will be a special offering for the United Methodist relief program. It's called UMCOR, and I can't remember what the initials stand for. So, committee, okay. United Methodist Committee on Relief, okay. And then finally, we're still collecting Easter cards to be given to those in the care facilities, and you can give those contributions to Betty Fink. All right. Then I have an announcement here asking that we all help take care to completely close the exterior doors when we leave, that even though they close and will lock when they're closed, we have to be sure they're closed. So they want us to give a little tug and then make a little test of it to be sure that they're closed. This is just for the case of security. And then finally, the announcements I have, this letter comes from Donna Heisey. She says, Dear Monthalia friends, helping hands in the kitchen, serving those who need a hand, cookies bagged and ready for the table. What can I say but a big thank you again? I do appreciate your help and eager hands. I didn't want to see this service during Lent to be omitted. So if by serving a simple meal and short message is what we have for now, then I say that's a good thing. And that was thank you all from Donna Heisey. Does anyone else have an announcement? Oh, yes, and she even reminded me. I'm sorry. Lou needs your Easter lily orders no later than next week. I think we'd ask that it be today, but we're giving you another week. Okay? If there's nothing else, let's head on out to the rest of our service. you'll all stand with me now for our call to worship. Blessed are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed are those whom the Lord does not hold guilty, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. You may be seated.
Even before the world was created, God knew that Jesus would be the way, the truth, and the life for all who believed in him. But God didn't just ignore his people then, waiting until the time came for Jesus. No, he gave them a way to be forgiven. If they offered sacrifices from a heart of worship, they could renew their friendship with God as they proved their reliance on him. But people did not rely on God. Some did not follow his way of sacrifice and worship, and there was an even deeper problem. Many may have followed the outward ritual, but they didn't trust God in their hearts. They didn't love him. They didn't live lives that reflected his glory. The Lord called Moses and spoke to him from the tent of meeting, saying, "Speak to the people of Israel and say to them, 'When any one of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of livestock from the herd or from the flock. He shall bring it to the entrance of the tent of meeting, that he may be accepted before the Lord. He shall lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I will give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul?' He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, 'In the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt, I did not speak to your fathers or command them concerning burnt offerings and sacrifices. But this command I gave them: Obey my voice, and I will be your God, and you shall be my people, and walk in all the way that I command you, that it may be well with you.' But they did not obey or incline their ear, but walked in their own counsels and the stubbornness of their evil hearts, and went backward and not forward. From the day that your fathers came out of the land of Egypt to this day, I have persistently sent all my servants, the prophets, to them, day after day. Yet they did not listen to me or incline their ear, but stiffen their neck. They did worse than their fathers. So you shall speak all these words to them, but they will not listen to you. You shall call to them, but they will not answer you. And you shall say to them, 'This is the nation that did not obey the voice of the Lord their God, and did not accept discipline. Truth has perished. It is cut off from their lips.'" The reading's taken from Leviticus 1:1-4, Psalm 51:16-17, and Jeremiah 7:21-28.
Now, if those who are able, please stand for our hymns of praise. We're going to sing "To God Be the Glory." It's in your book on page 98.
Thank you.
pamphlets, Seeing Christ is Risen. It's on the handout in the black folder in front of you in the hymnal rack. And on the other side of it, you'll see God So Loved. So we're going to sing Christ is Risen.
Is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the
Okay, now you can be seated, and it's time for Children's Church.
Jesus loves me, yes, I know.
Through the Bible tells me so. Let our weak, but he is strong.
Yes, Jesus loves me.
Yes. morning.
Good morning.
How's it going? Good. Well, so I have a question. Have you ever done this before? What are these kids doing? Yeah, they're having a race, aren't they? Which one do you think is going to get the award? The green guy, yeah, why?
He passed the finish line.
He passed the finish line. Look at those other kids. How do you think they feel?
Sad.
Yeah, tired, sad. Well, what if I said the guy in the green shirt doesn't get the reward? The guy in the blue shirt who's so much further behind, he gets the award. He was trying hard. What did you say, Harper? Yeah, well, slow and steady does sometimes win the race. But usually, when you race, the person who gets to the finish line first wins, right? What about, well, Avery, I know you're playing softball. Anybody playing other sports? Softball? Where do you play? Oh, bless you. T-ball? Oh, I love T-ball. Harper? Softball. So at the end of the game, oh, Merritt, where are you playing, hon?
Golf? Oh, my.
Oh, I called you. Creed. Sorry. I know. I got mixed up. What are you playing, Creed? Or golf? Wow. You have to have a lot of patience to play golf. So.
I know.
Yeah? Are you do? Well, let me think here. So, our story today, our scripture from the Bible, is a story called says, here, Ella, will you take this for me? He says, here, take your half of the money. Sorry, Waylon, I'll give you a high five. Not quite, oh, well, look at you sharing. So the younger boy took off and he gave away all of his dad's money, all that money his dad had saved up. He spent it on parties and clothes and all kinds of things that really weren't very good. And then all of a sudden, he looked in his hand, and guess what? It was. You're exactly right. Everything was gone. He'd spent it all. And then his stomach started to growl. Let me hear your stomach growl. mistakes all the time, right? We make bad choices. And God sent, who did God send to save us? His son, whose name is? Jesus, yeah. And Jesus Christ died for all of us. He took all of our sins, all of our bad choices, and he laid them up at the cross. And that is why we celebrate Easter, right?
Now, if able, if you'll please stand and join me in the prayer for illumination, and then after that, remain standing for our first scripture. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Our first scripture today comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, 15th chapter, verses 1 through 3, and then skipping over to the second half of verse 11 through 32. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him. And the Pharisees and scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of property that will belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country, and there squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am, dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, the father saw him and was filled with compassion, and ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one. Put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard the music and the dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. And he replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command, yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when the son of yours comes back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.' This is the word of God."
Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Our second scripture today comes to us from the book of Corinthians, the second book of Corinthians, 5th chapter, verses 16 through 21. "From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors of Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of God. So this morning we have the parable of the prodigal. And I'm going to deal with it a little, but I want to come to a different place in just a bit. For anyone who doesn't recall or needs a refresher course, Jesus is eating with some tax collectors and some sinners. Some scribes and some Pharisees come as well. And they begin to grumble that this holy man, this righteous man, is eating with sinners. Now, I have vilified the Pharisees for a number of years. But today I want to back up a little bit. I want to help us understand that, yes, they miss the message of grace. But as they understand God, they are trying to prove up to God and do the things that they believe need to be done so that Christ, so that God and they can be together. The Pharisees are said to have somewhere over 400 different laws that they try to abide by. I'm not sure I can remember 400 laws if I tried to do that, let alone know when I've stepped over the bounds. And sometimes it's hard to know when you step over the bounds with some of the things. When we were in Israel, Karen and I happened to be on the Sabbath. And the elevator was a Sabbath elevator. You see, there was a judgment somewhere by the rabbis that do that sort of thing, that pushing a button for your floor on the Sabbath was too much work. So the elevator, a Sabbath elevator, is designed so that on the Sabbath, it starts out at the bottom floor, the doors open, it pauses for a bit, kind of like a subway or something, the doors automatically close, it goes up one floor exactly, stops, and the doors open and lets you off or on. And it goes all the way up the building, however many floors there are, stopping and opening and closing and going to the next one. And when it goes all the way up, it comes all the way down. Because then all you have to do is get on and wait and wait. We were on the sixth floor when we discovered the Sabbath elevator. Some of the laws are a little off, at least to me. But the Pharisees are doing their very utmost to try and follow all the laws, the regulations, the ordinances, the cultural understandings that they had to help bring themselves closer to God. So when they see Jesus eating with tax collectors, which were probably the worst of sinners, and others that they knew, there was a reputation, there was a cultural response about people. Knew that they were sinners. Then they begin to grumble and question. And that is when Jesus says, let me tell you a story. Let me tell you a parable. And here's a man. He has two sons, older son, younger son. The younger son, like younger sons, sometimes will do is a little bit on the brash side. And he gets to a certain age, says, I want to explore. I like the way you put it, Tracy. I want to go out and see the world and do the things. come at this scripture from a 20th century or now a 21st century understanding, but I want to bring us back to about a first century understanding. My wife has an uncle who came over to this country from Germany and never returned back to see his family. Because in Germany in the early 1900s, the system of inheritance was the older son got everything. And anybody else that was male had to strike out on their own. So he came to this country where there was land available, where there was a prospect of growth and enrichment, doing something to make a living. That was in the 20th century, 1900s. In the first century, the father is being gracious to give the younger son anything. Scripture says he gave him his share. It doesn't tell us for sure what the share is, but he says he gave him his share. The younger son does just what he said. He says, "Oh, I've got all this money. I'm going to go just explore the world, see things, do things, be whoever I want to be." One of the things I find in my life, just a personal observation, is that if you have a person who feels like they have been controlled all their life to a certain point, and then they suddenly go, "Whoo, I'm free. I can do anything I want. I can go anywhere I want. I can have friends of anybody I want." There tends to be a time of exploration of what is it I want to do. I don't have any cultural restrictions. I don't have any parental restrictions. I don't have anything holding me back. I've got a wad of money and I can go wherever I want. And one of the things that the younger son first does is leaves home, because he knows that if he stays there, he has the same friends. He has the same structures of the culture and the parents and the family that would try to hold him back even when he doesn't want to. Some of us get off to a place called college. And all of a sudden, the restrictions that we grew up with, the things that we thought we knew, are, I can make my own decisions. I can go with my own people. I can meet new friends. And lots of us make some mistakes along the way about that time. And some of us that don't go off to college still hit the same time in our lives. We're out from under mom and daddy's roof. We're out from under their rules and regulations and expectations. And one of the things the younger son discovers is what I am willing to believe that many of us have discovered in this room, that it doesn't matter how big your pile of money is, if it's only going out, it doesn't take long for it to, because if nothing's coming in, what you thought was more than enough forever suddenly is not. Some of us have discovered that as we get close to retirement. I'm not saying anything, you know, but it's just the way it is. You've got to deal with what is. So the younger son goes off, makes this revelation that it's not working, that he's hungry, one of the basic things. And he says, back home, even though they're hired hands, my father's servants aren't hungry. They have more than enough to eat and to even share. And here where I am, if I don't pay for something, I got nothing. He heads back home. He realizes his mistake. Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. He gets part of that out when he actually gets to his father. But his father is so grateful, so pleased, so exuberant that he has come home, that he is safe, that he is sound, that he is here. He calls the servants to bring the robes, bring the sandals, bring the rings, kill a fatted calf, let's throw a party. We're going to have a big Texas barbecue. Come on. I said that if you read this scripture, almost everybody can find themselves somewhere in this scripture. A lot of us find ourselves in that prodigal son, or at least part of our lives there. A number of us, we don't like to admit this, but a number of us find ourselves in that elder son spot. Who's hurt, who's mad, who's angry. He comes home, he hears the dancing, the music, and he says, this son that has wasted your money has come back, and you throw a party for him, for his friends, you kill a fatted calf. You didn't even give me a tiny little scrawny goat to celebrate with my friends. And some of us, sometimes I think many of us find ourselves in different roles at different times, find ourselves in that place of the forgiving and loving Father who welcomes him back, explains the son, your brother who was lost is found, your brother who was dead is back alive. Several years ago, when I was in the Austin district, we got together for a preacher district meeting. And we had a fella come and preach on this, and he specifically told us everybody can find themselves somewhere in this story. And he asked us, who all finds yourself the younger brother? Who all finds yourself the older brother? Who all finds yourself in the loving father? Now, this was a group of preachers. All of us knew where we wanted to be. So there was a big group that was, oh, I'm the loving father. And I know some of those preachers, and they weren't all that loving sometimes. But there was one who was a holdout. And the person that was leading thing asked if there was any others that had not identified, and this one hand goes up. And we all recognize whose hand that is. And I want to tell you, this is a group of pastors, but that particular pastor had a lot of personal issues over the last few months. And it was very public. It was a little before social media was a big thing, but I can tell you whether it's something called Facebook, or whether it's just the telephone or the parking lot, there's always been a social media. That hand goes up, and the leader asks, well, do you find yourself in the story? He says, yes, I do. So he asks, loaded question, he probably shouldn't have asked. But he asks, well, if it's not the father, if it's not the elder son, not the younger son, where do you find yourself in the story? He says, I am the fatted calf. Because I have been skewered and slaughtered by some of the people in the room. Whoa. Now all of a sudden some of those hands that went up saying, oh yes, I'm the father. I'm the forgiving father. I'm the loving, generous father. He didn't have to name names. It was pretty well known. Most of us find ourselves somewhere in this story. But Jesus tells this story for a purpose, for a reason. Jesus tells this story because of the people who want so hard to be God's people that they have over 400 rules and regulations and ordinances and cultural acceptances that they are expected to live by. And somehow they lose sight of I volunteered for this, and they want to hold everybody else to that same standard. Christians do that sometimes. I'm a Christian. I'm a preacher. We were preparing for a grace journey over a year ago. And one of the members is giving his testimony about how he came to Christ and how he began to realize who he was and where he was. And at one point, and I happen to know enough of this man's story, he gets to one point in his testimony, and he says, I quit going to this church and I started going to that church because I was too holy for that one. And I laughed out loud. And I was the only one that laughed out loud. Everybody else is kind of like, you shouldn't say things like that. Well, he shouldn't. But he said it as a joke because he knew he wasn't holy. And I was the one that got it. This morning, I want to remind us that Jesus tells this story because of people like us. Because of people who are sinners like us. Because of people who are short of where God calls us to be. And that's not to tell you need to do better. I've done that before. I know that's true. That's to tell you that even while you are there, hear me, even when you are at your worst version of yourself, God is absolutely in love with you. Desires to be with you. And yet there is a barrier, because even when we're at our best, we're not at the level where God is. We don't measure up, which is why as Christians we understand that we put on, if you will, Jesus Christ. He relieves us of the burden of our sins and allows us to be holy as God, or at least seen as such, because our sins are washed away. This morning, let us be a people of faith. On my way across the river to give this sermon, Doug Hanna is on Sirius XM radio. And he says, someone told me not long ago that if the worst person, the biggest sinner in your life is not you, you're probably not looking at you very hard. That hit home with me. I hope it hits home with you. God loves us, each and every one. God knows us and cares for us, each and every one, in our very best and our very worst versions. God loves you. Amen.
As we sing for the stand for the hymn of response, I'd like to remind everyone that the communion rail is open to all for prayer while we sing this hymn. And it's Seek Ye First. It says times two. There's two verses. We'll sing each verse one time. If you'll stand, please. As we remain standing, let's say in unison our affirmation. It's the modern affirmation on page 885. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
We believe in God the Father,
infinite in wisdom, power in love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
Come to that time we call the prayers of the people an opportunity for you to lift up those joys, sorrows, thanksgivings, and concerns. You've had several minutes to fill out those pieces, brightly colored pieces of paper with your prayer requests on them. We'll come by and gather those. I think I've got one up here. Carol Irwin, who is in hospital in Austin with a stroke, and for Dorothy Smith. Dorothy Smith at the Romberg House. Al, is it Pakabush? Pakabush? Pakabush. Brenda Robinson, treatment for cancer. Prayers for a good beneficial rain. Not everyone's going to know, but Bob Kidd was a member of the Belmont Church. He passed away. Yes, sir. Okay. Those of you who are interested, the funeral for Bob Kidd is this afternoon, 3 o'clock at the Belmont Church across the river. Let's go to the Lord. Gracious Lord, we come before you, loving you, and yet knowing that we don't love as well. Trying our best, Lord. At least on occasion, trying our best to be your people. Lord, help us to try our best more often. Help me, Lord, to remember that I am a sinner saved by grace. And I want to be one of your saints. I want to be one that is the person you want me to be. Help us each and every one, Lord, as we lift up these, the prayers of our lips. Help us each and every one, Lord, as we lift up to you the prayers of our hearts and souls as well. thank you that in all things you are good to us, even in the midst of the most terrible moments of time. Lord, I want to particularly take just a moment and give thanks for each one, whether they are in this congregation or seeing us online or some other way. Each one, Lord, who were born this month, born during March, for they are blessings to us, each and every one. And we lift them up to you, Lord, that you would be with them day in and day out, moment by moment, and that they would come to recognize your presence with you, or with them more and more. Lord, these things we ask in the powerful name of our risen Savior, the one who says, pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As a forgiven and reconciled people, people of faith and of practice, one of the ways in which we offer our gifts to God is through our morning offering. If the ushers would come forward at this time. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the many gifts that you have given us. Help us, Lord, to return not just the gifts from our checkbooks, but the gifts of our heart, the gifts of our life. In Christ's name.
Remain standing for the hymn of dedication. We're going to sing Jesus is All the World to Me. During this hymn, if you'd like to join this church, please come forward at this time.
forth in the love of God. Go forth in the recognition of God. Go forth in the very presence of an almighty, loving, and merciful God in